Welcome to Morgantown for the Mountaineers' Gold Rush home opener. And their junior quarterback, Will Grier, will make his home debut for West Virginia against the Pirates of East Carolina. FS1 college football kicks off right now. Pushcar Stadium. They're expecting 60,000 strong for this home opener for the West Virginia Mountaineers. They take on the Pirates of East Carolina. Hello, everyone. I'm Brian Custer alongside Ben Lieber and partner. We got two programs here. Both dropped their season opener. Both looking for their first victory of the season.
And what a great place to play football. West Virginia, Morgantown. It's going to be electric. Such a passionate crowd. It's going to be tough for ECU. They need to come out and start fast, explosive plays. They need to get some good taste in the mouth. This is a tough, stingy defense.
Well, let's start with the Mountaineers. And, of course, West Virginia is led by their quarterback, Will Grier, transferred here from Florida. Named the Big 12 newcomer of the week. Threw for 371 in the season opener. That's the most yards ever for a quarterback out of West Virginia making his debut.
Well, and if you can believe it, last week against Virginia Tech, he started off kind of slow. It didn't take him a while to get in a rhythm. Took the whole first half. Second half was electric. You know, saw the Will Grier that I think everybody saw at Florida. This guy likes to get outside the pocket and make plays. If you like backyard football, you're going to love Will Grier. It's not a coverage that's too tight that he won't throw into. He trusts his receivers to go up and make plays. He loves to make plays with his feet as well.
Now, for East Carolina, it took them really a game. Well, let's be honest, basically a half for them to make a change at quarterback. Thomas Cirque will get the start today.
Yeah, he will. Gardner Minshew just did not vibe very well with the offense last week. And Cirque comes in the second half and plays really well. He was, you know, sort of the catalyst or the energy. He has a better timing and a rhythm with his receivers. And this guy is very tough. He likes to run the football. I expect early and often this game for a lot of quarterback run game to get him in rhythm.
East Carolina looking for their first road victory in nearly 2 years. But Will Grier and the Mountaineers are going to try to make the Pirates walk the plank. It's the home opener. And the kick for West Virginia, East Carolina, it's next. FS1 College Football is sponsored by Dave and Buster's. Beautiful day here for football, 61 degrees. Here's Scotty Montgomery, the head pirate, second season. Went 3-10 last season. Of course, Dana Holgorsen leads the Mountaineers. This is his seventh season. He's led this team to bowl appearances in 3 out of the last 4 years. And they finished 10-3 last season, and that was the most wins for this program since joining the Big 12.
Well, Brian, already an interesting strategy. East Carolina wins the toss. They've lost 10 of their last 11 games. They decide to defer and give West Virginia in this very potent offense first crack at it here in this game. So let's see if the strategy pays off, not only in the first half, but also in the second.
And you see Marcus Sims there. He's back. He was suspended for the season opener for the Mountaineers. He's got elite 4.3 speed. Caleb Pratt. He will kick things off for East Carolina. And we are underway. That one sits deep into the end zone. Ben, let's talk about what to watch for with the Mountaineers when they have the football.
You know, I just mentioned that West Virginia offense, and I know we're going to talk a lot about Will Grier, but, you know, to me, everything starts and stops with the running game. No secret there. Justin Crawford, one of the best in the Big 12, averaged 7.3 yards a carry last year. He's going to get a lot of chances here tonight. And for ECU, their linebackers have to play better. Too many runs last week that got up to the third level. They have to play downhill.
Justin Crawford gets the first carry, goes off that left side. And he's close to a first down.
Well, that's the sort of thing I'm talking about. He's going to get a lot of opportunities. You're going to see right now, West Virginia averages about three plays per minute, so they're already lined up, ready to go.
And you see this air raid spread offense. They love tempo. Crawford again, another carry. That's Chris Love with the tackle.
Crawford's going to come off. He lost a shoe.
Kennedy McCoy will check in. Out to David Seals. Seals is knocked out of bounds. Close to that first down marker. Take a look at what Greer did last week. 371 for three touchdowns at just one pick. Here's Kennedy McCoy. Gets to the outside. Knocked out of bounds. But he's inside Pirate territory. Tim Urban knocked him out of bounds.
Well, the key block on that was 55, Yodney Kajust. He's the left tackle. Really captured the edge there, allowed Crawford to get around the outside. We're going to see right now Tevin Bush, number 14, electric player in the backfield.
Greer looking deep, and he's got a man. He's got a step. Marcus Sims, but he's out of bounds.
Well, if you're East Carolina right now, already on defense, you're already a little winded. You need an incomplete pass just to catch your breath. West Virginia runs at an electric rate of plays offensively.
They are rotating their backfield. Kennedy McCoy now in. Greer, the slant to Seals. And right there at the first down marker.
You know, so much happened on that play. They go 3-by-1 to the right side, trips formation, a tight bunch. They set up what looked like was going to be a screen pass, and then Sills just releases in for that quick little slant, and Greer hits him in stride.
Kennedy McCoy, and he is wrapped up behind the line of scrimmage by Jordan Williams. Williams had 14 tackles last week.
Well, and he's one of those guys I was talking about that has to step up in this game. He's a leading tackler last year. And, you know, he's really the heart and soul of this defense. He has to come downhill just like Tim Urban, number one, to really make some plays and stop this running game.
Swing. Goal. Picks up a block. And he's inside the 10-yard line. Drop by Corin Wiggins.
Well, you can see already not just the number of plays, but the variety of plays that they run for West Virginia.
Crawford. In the backfield, he gets the carry. Up the middle, powers his way. West Virginia's on the board. Well, they said they wanted to run the football early and often, and they did just that, considering East Carolina gave up well over 400 yards rushing last week to James Madison.
Well, and again, a lot of these run plays, they're getting a hat on a hat. They're getting guys moved out of the way. They're capturing the edges. They're playing with good angles. Just much more physical, more well-coached on that first drive for West Virginia.
And Mike Molina kicks it in. Justin Crawford takes it in from 5 yards out. They go 9 to play, 75 yards. West Virginia up 7-0. Welcome back to Morgantown. That Mountaineer will certainly be in shape with more drives like that opening drive for the Mountaineers.
Well, that was a clinic, wasn't it? I mean, it was run, it was pass, it was left, it was right. They're pulling guards, they're pulling tackles. That was a clinic by West Virginia there, and I have a feeling that Mountaineer is going to get a lot more push-ups in if East Carolina's defense cannot figure this out.
Trayvon Brown back deep, the junior. For East Carolina, the freshman, Evan Stanley, kicks things away. Brown from his own 2. Across the 20. Drop at the 23. Let's talk about what to watch for. Thomas Cerf has the football.
Well, like we said, the open cert came in the second half and played pretty well, had two interceptions, but, you know, it's his toughness and the way that he can run the football as a quarterback that I think is going to be the difference for East Carolina. Expect early runs for him. And then Kaiser White, I don't think there's a more versatile player in the Big 12, if not the country. He's an outside linebacker. He's a nickel. He can blitz off the edge. He can play deep half. That guy's going to be everywhere all game long.
Tyshawn Dye in the backfield alongside Cirk. He'll throw it. And that one's complete to Jimmy Williams. Williams, the senior. They said they wanted to get the ball to him early.
Yeah, they really do. They say that, you know, he is probably their best player on the outside. They said he's got a lot of suddenness, a lot of quickness, that start and stop ability. So you're right. Early in this game, they want to get in the best playmaker's hands, and that's Jimmy Williams.
This is Dye. The right side. We've got a flag on the play. It's about a yard short of the first down. Dylan Tonkery with the stop.
Holding number 60, the offense. 10-yard penalty, second down.
That's on Austin Lee. Michael Roach, our referee.
Well, Austin Lee, he came in last week as a redshirt freshman. You'll see him right there on your right side of the screen. Number 60, handling some big guys up front. It's a little bit of a soft hold there. Didn't even see a lot of jersey pulled, but he got his first start last week as a redshirt freshman. Actually graded out the highest of all the offensive linemen, so a lot of potential for Austin Lee.
This is second and 15, under pressure. Natalie intercepted. Dropped as soon as he let that one go.
Well, it's 46. Reese Donahue, their right defensive end in this 3-3-5. You'll see him right there. Just a free release on the inside.
Toya's Avery,
the quarterback.
That's Toya's Avery, almost came up with that pick. So now third down, third and 15 from their own 18. Sir. He's looking for Williams. And that's complete. What a catch by Jimmy Williams.
Well, that is a heck of a catch. They bring a blitz off the defensive right side. They go man-to-man coverage on the outside. And Cirque has to put it on the outside of the sidelines and use that separation that Jimmy Williams got to make the play. That was a nice throw and a good adjustment, good body control by Jimmy Williams to make the catch.
On the field is a completed catch for a first down. Plays under review.
They'll take another look at it. Goes for 27 yards.
We talked about that rhythm that Cirque has with his receivers. I think you're seeing it on display right here. Possession. To me, it looks like hip is on the ground. Most of his body's on the ground.
Well, let's bring in our official rules expert, Mike Pereira from Los Angeles. Mike, what do you think?
I think it's a heck of a play by that receiver. He's got to maintain control of the ball when he's going to the ground because he is directly going to the ground, but he does. Foot hits first. That's a heck of a catch, and that'll stay a catch.
Mike, appreciate it.
Thank you, Mike.
It's confirmed. Thank you, Mike. You're right on it. Confirmed it's a catch. Goes for 27 yards.
Well, they handled the first test against this defense. As I mentioned, they called a 3-3-5. It's kind of a 3-hybrid 3-4. They've been a lot of pressure, a lot of different looks. You're going to get challenged man-to-man, and that was a man-to-man blitz right there that East Carolina won.
And it was 3rd and 15. Keep in mind, they were just 6-16 last week. On third down. Big conversion. Once again from the gun. Under pressure. Cirque gets it out in the flat. That's Quay Johnson. Johnson's the senior. Knightdale, North Carolina. Kaiser White with the stop.
Well, once again, West Virginia lines up pretty stagnant. Linebackers 5 yards off the ball, and then all of a sudden, all three guys blitz. So now you get a 6-man pressure. Offensive line does a good job holding up.
dive. Spins off a man. He's got a first down.
Well, you mentioned earlier, Tyshawn Dye is a guy that did not get a lot of carries last game, and the coaches actually, after the game, were kind of annoyed by it. They're like, listen, we want to get this guy more involved. We just didn't have enough, you know, quality first downs. We weren't very efficient. Kind of got us out of rhythm, made us a little one-dimensional, limited our playbook a little bit. They said, we're going to make an emphasis this game to get number 22 Dye involved in the game, running and catching the football.
He's big. He's physical. He's a grad transfer out of Clemson. Cirque again, looking. That one incomplete. He was looking at Jimmy Williams.
Well, they had the right coverage. They had everything blocked up front. They max protected. They asked Tyshawn Dye to come down from the running back position, provide some support on the edge. And Cirque just misfired. The route was good. It was read properly. Good route, bad ball.
Second and 10. Looks like Cirque's changing the play. 5 seconds on the play clock. Steps up the pocket. Got some room to run. About a yard shy of a first down.
Well, and that's the confusing part about this defense is they showed the same look a few plays ago. They brought a six-man pressure. This time they show the look. They only rushed three. They drop eight. And that confuses Cirque at the line a little bit. Has to change the call. And there's at least enough defenders to come down and make the play.
And another third down. Third and three. From the gun. DeAndre Ferrier in motion. Cirque. Screen over the middle. That's incomplete. He's looking for Trevon Brown.
And we're going to talk a lot about this pressure that West Virginia likes to bring. You're going to see Tonkery just come free. So many miscommunication issues on the offensive line as you play against this team because you don't know where the counts are. You have guys coming up to the line, dropping out of the line. They blitz from disguise and from depth. It's very hard. You're going to see a lot of free rushers as this game plays out.
Fourth down. They were 2 of 5 on fourth down last week. Cirque looking left. He's got a man open. It is DeAndre Ferrier.
What a tremendous job. You're going to see Ferrier, number one right there. A little bit of a pick play by Grayson on the outside. They bring another blitz from the defense. I think the defensive backfield gets a little bit of a miscommunication issue on the outside, and who's supposed to be outside leverage. Nice fourth down conversion for East Carolina.
So now from the Mountaineer 29, first and 10 for the Pirates. The fake to Dye. Ferrier getting on the outside. JUCO transfer was just stopped.
Another quick little screen pass to the left. Trying to pick up a few yards. They get in a manageable situation now, second and 6. Already a much different offense than last week against James Madison. Too many times where they're behind the sticks on second down, second long, third and long. Doing a nice job of managing the game and managing the tempo of this game right now for East Carolina.
Off tackle. The fake. Cirque kept it. Third down on that left side. Maybe a couple.
You always have to be leery of Cirque when he's back there on that, those RPOs, those run pass options. He likes to run the football. He's not afraid to get hit. The one thing I like watching about him as far as a quarterback in the pocket, he'll stay in a hot pocket and throw the ball even though he knows he's going to get hit.
Third down again. Third and 4. We got trips here at the bottom of your screen. Cirque, though, looking up top. That one is short, but we got a flag on the play. Once again, he was looking for Jimmy Williams. And they're going to call the flag on Toyus Avery.
Pass interference, number 16 to the defense. 15-yard penalty automatic, first down.
Well, West Virginia goes 0 blitz. That means they have no safeties. Deep in the middle of the field, it's manned up all the way on the outside against the empty formation. And it was an underthrown ball that just happened to work out right for East Carolina. I think he didn't want to put it in that spot, but he had to get the ball out quick because of the zero blitz, and Toyus Avery got a little too handsy, a little too grabby. So now we have first and goal for East Carolina.
Here they go. We're inside the red zone. Zerk looking. Plenty of time. He's got him in the back of the end zone. It was too high for DeAndre Ferry.
He missed that so badly. DeAndre Ferrier, you can see him right in the middle of this. Watch the middle of your screen. Look at his hand up. His hand up, and he just didn't see him until too late. There was not a defender within 10 yards of him. So big-time breakdown for West Virginia. Missed opportunity for East Carolina.
Dive up the middle. And he dropped at the 4. Ivan Askew-Henry with the stop.
So this is a situation now where you have a running quarterback. He can break tackles. Third down. I would expect some sort of run-pass option here for Cirk. Something maybe on the outside. If something's not there to throw it, maybe he can run it in using his legs.
Dalton Montgomery comes in. The tight end position. The fake. Cirk kept it, and he got nothing. Big stop by Al-Rashid Benton.
Well, they went with the straight design run for the quarterback. And one of the smartest guys on the defense, Al-Rashid Benton, right there, just does such a nice job playing that inside out, very patient with his read, comes down and makes the sure tackle.
Jake Verity, the sophomore. Come in. This is from 24 yards out. He puts it right through. So the Pirates are on the board as well. 7-3, our score in the first quarter.
Man. It's always a good game.
Love that. East Carolina going 14 plays, 70 yards. They get a field goal on their first offensive possession. Marcus Sims back deep. Caleb Pratt kicks it away. Sims thought about it, takes it out. Up the middle. Nearly to the 30. He dropped it to 29.
Ooh, he had a nice little stutter step there. I think it was, I don't think it was planned. It was all reaction, but it actually allowed the blocks to be set up a little bit. And he kind of stutter step, put his foot back in the ground and got vertical. You saw a little bit of that pure speed that, Brian, you talked about. Coaches just love how true speed that he has going vertically.
Will Greer. Hands it off to Crawford, and Crawford is met behind the line. That thing was all blown up by Tyree Owens. Lost 4 yards on that play. They'll run it again. Crawford, Bobby Folt with the stop.
It's already a pretty good answer, not only for East Carolina's offense to go all the way down the field and chew up 6.5 minutes on the clock, only get 3 points, but they got points on the board, and now so far a good answer by this defense as they put West Virginia in third and long.
And first time for West Virginia now facing a third down. Converted nearly 26% of those. Last week, he converts one here. Tyron White makes the catch.
And Greer would never have found the open receiver had he had so much time for the offensive line. They provide great pass protection. And once again, you see how quickly West Virginia can line back up and get the next play going. Conditioning is going to be a big factor for East Carolina's defense.
David Seals, the receiver screen. He picked up 6 on that one. Again, they go with that up-tempo. Crawford. Left side. First down.
Justin Crawford on
He's inside Pirate territory. Jordan Williams.
First down, West Virginia.
Jim Irvin also there. Pressure coming from the Pirates. Up top, he's got a man, he's got a stunt, and it's caught by Gary Jennings.
It's just a straight go route by James, a stop on the outside, and James just goes streaking down the field. This is an area where they want Will Greer to get a little better, is ball placement on the deep shots, and that one was pretty.
38 yards, Greer. That one's incomplete.
Boy, he about got his receiver killed on that one.
Looking for Caron White.
Looking for the quick screen on the outside. The ball placement way too upfield. And thankfully, that wasn't a bigger collision as Caron White had his head down trying to reach for that ball.
East Carolina calls a timeout. We got a good one here in Morgantown. 7-3 Mountaineers. Our score here in the first quarter. First and goal for the Mountaineers after a 38-yard pitch and catch by Will Greer and Gary Jennings. David Seals is at the bottom of your screen. That's someone Greer loves to look to in the red zone. Jennings up top. He's going to go up top. And it's caught. Caron White. Touchdown, Mountaineers.
It's the initial setup that I think throws ECU's defense off. They go full house backfield, single coverage on the outside. Caron White up near the boundary. Such a nice job of just stemming to the inside, then pivoting or going back outside to create some separation. And a nice ball by Will Greer as another nice drive and a great answer for West Virginia.
Mike Molina puts it in as Caron White with the 7-yard touchdown catch. Mountaineers go 71 yards in 8 plays. They're up 14-3. Mr. Mountaineer does a push-up for every score. West Virginia, he's going to get a workout today. Mountaineers, second offensive drive, get another touchdown.
Well, here's the 38-yard play that set everything up for Gary Jennings. It's just strict speed. There's nothing fancy about it. There's a stop on the outside. The corner doesn't even bite on the stop route. The corner and safety now have to sandwich that guy. They underestimate his speed. And here's the touchdown to Caron White. Does a good job of single coverage, stems to the inside, gets back out to that back corner of the end zone. And Will Greer puts enough loft on it for him to adjust and make the easy touchdown. So two really impressive drives for West Virginia, not only just throwing the football, but also effectively running the football.
And there was a penalty on the extra point. East Carolina, a face mask. So that's why you can see the Mountaineers are kicking it from midfield. Chris Love is back deep for the Pirates. Let's get a game break. Sam Harper. Appreciate it. Second offensive series now for the Pirates. Tyshawn Dye, Thomas Cirque. Cirque from the gun. Bad snap right out of the hands of Cirque. And that's John Spellacy, who, of course, the center. He's a freshman. They've had some issues with that offensive line.
Yeah, they really have. They've had some big issues. Garrett McGinn, their left guard, was actually the starting center last week against James Madison. He had 5 errant snaps as well. They moved him to left guard. They brought in Brandon Pena. He was the backup to center. He gets injured. So now the third center, John Spellacy, is in this game. Like you said, he's a true freshman playing against the West Virginia Mountaineers.
Second and 24
Signed out with the carry. And it's interesting, there's a lot that you can learn a little bit from pregame. And we saw an errant snap in pregame as well from Spellacy, hoping that was just some pregame jitters, but clearly showing up here in the game right now in the second drive for East Carolina.
Spellacy, the freshman out of Cleveland at the St. Ignatius High School. Hussein Howell in the backfield alongside Cirk from the gun. He steps up. He'll take off. He gets to the 20, the original line of scrimmage. John Lewis with the stop.
Well, you didn't expect too risky of a play offensively for East Carolina. Backed up third and really long. West Virginia only brought three guys, dropped eight, not a whole lot of passing lanes. The smart thing to do was try to pick up something to give your punter some room.
Austin Barnes, the senior, transfer from Eastern Michigan. He will punt it away. Marcus Sims standing back at his own 30. This is from his own 25. Up the middle, 40, 45, where he's brought down. Will Greer get another opportunity? He was a four-star recruit out of North Carolina. Started his career, went to Florida. Started five games, played in six of them. They were 6-0. Then was suspended. Man tested positive for a banned substance. Got his first start last week. Threw for 371. Kennedy McCoy in the backfield. He gets the carry, and he is dropped.
The give is to Kennedy McCoy. Dropped by number 5, Corey Sargent.
Just a good play by Sargent. He's a backup corner that's playing in this game. Came right off the edge. Colton McKibbitt's direct tackle just did not get a clean block on him, and he gets a tackle right at the line of scrimmage.
Greer looking deep for Seals. Got it. He pulled down at about the 15. Bobby Fulton.
Well, it was a fake on the outside. They set up all that wide receiver screen action, that quick horizontal action. They get a complimentary deep route from Sills and Will Greer with another nice deep ball.
40-yard pickup, hand up inside. Kennedy McCoy. And he's in for another touchdown, just like that, for West Virginia.
They went Dick Spavital, the offensive coordinator for West Virginia. This is the first year that Dana Holgorsen is not calling the plays. He brings in Spavital, which he's had a history with. Trust him enough to run his offense, and I tell you what, he is doing such a tremendous job of keeping this defense off balance, setting a lot of things up with screens, and a fake screen, then a running game. He's pulling guys in the run scheme, getting a lot of beef in this defense's face, and he's got a whole stable of running backs that he trusts to make plays.
Three offensive possessions for West Virginia, three touchdowns. This one, three plays, 53 yards. They did it in 45 seconds. They've now had three possessions, three scores. All of them have come basically under 2 minutes and 20 seconds. Here comes Mike Molina for the extra point. And boots it right through. Oh, Will Greer threw for 371. Having another big day. Kennedy McCoy scores for West Virginia.
Well, you just mentioned how quickly they can score. 6 of 7 scoring drives under 3 minutes, 2 minutes, 50 seconds. You know, the thing that I enjoy about watching West Virginia's offense is traditionally when you think of Dana Holgorsen and everything that he's implemented, it's sort of the air raid offense where they spread four, five guys out wide and they want to throw the ball around. But it's really morphed into a power running game, albeit from the gun position, but they have a fullback back there, Elijah Wellman, number 28. He's sort of the H-back that will be the lead blocker in all that plays. So you'll see traditional power plays, traditional run, lead plays, everything that they throw at you, some counter plays. So you got to be ready for all of it. And then he still has the option of using his electric and quick and fast wide receivers on the outside.
Evan Zaley will do the kicking for West Virginia. Back deep is the senior Chris Love. Oh, Wake Forest, North Carolina.
Ooh, that'll be a penalty.
That one went out of bounds at about the 2-yard line.
Free kick out of bounds, number 30, the kicking team. Ball be placed in the 35-yard line. First down.
Well, get ready to start your day with First Things First. Weekday mornings on FS1. Host Chris Carter, Nick Wright. Kick off your day, the latest sports. First Thing First. Tuesday, 6:30 a.m. Eastern on FS1. Sir. Williams, receiver screen. He's got a first down.
That was an impressive job by East Carolina's offensive line to sort of get out there, free release, get some blockers out there on the wide receiver screen. West Virginia was sitting in a soft zone, so it allowed those guys to get the big bodies on them. So nice first play here for East Carolina. I've actually liked how they've responded throughout this game. This is a very tough defense, and I think they've managed it pretty well.
To give to Dye. Oh, boy. He ran right into a brick wall. Dylan Tonkery right there met him. Daniels as well.
You see Tonkery once again. He's made his presence felt, had a quarterback hit on a blitz in which he was free on the first series. And the redshirt freshman, just in his second game of his career, they are really excited about this young man. He can run sideline to sideline and make plays like that.
First 20-point-plus quarter of the season for West Virginia. Had two of them last season. They're up 21-3 over East Carolina in their home opener. FS1 College Football is sponsored by Dave and Buster's. Here in Morgantown. Mylan Pushkar Stadium for the home opener for the Mountaineers. We take a look at the first quarter stats. Talking about balance there. 144 through the air. Mountaineers 55 on the ground thus far. Here's Thomas Sirk in the Pirates. Looking at second and 11. Tyshawn Dye. And Sir throws the slant. It's complete to Jimmy Williams. It's a first down, and they're in Mountaineer territory.
A little bit of a chess match going on. Sirk comes up to the line. He doesn't like what he sees from the defense, changes the play. All the Mountaineers were kind of listening to what he was doing. All of a sudden, they give the hand signal like they're pushing up into the air. They change their defense. They now drop a bunch of guys, only rush to three guys. And ECU's offense does a good job of just readjusting on the pass route and hitting that slant.
Williams, four catches, 53 yards receiving already. The fake, that's Quay Johnson. We got flags everywhere. Dean Bailey made the stop.
It may be on the block on the outside with the receiver coming in.
Personal foul. Legal block below the waist, number 85 of the offense. 15-yard penalty, first down.
Devin Grayson.
In the interest of protection for all players, including defensive guys, if you're on the outside like that, you cannot go low and attack at his legs. He cuts him down right there. You have to attack him up high.
With the penalty.
And he goes low, and that's the reason for the flag.
First and 24 for ECU ball.
And the ball's not beyond the line of scrimmage, and that's the difference on those sort of blocks.
Now first and 24. Usain Howe has checked in for the Pirates. And we got a timeout by ECU. That's their second. First and 24 for the Pirates of ECU. Down 18. Thomas Cirk takes off.
Cirk on the
field. Adam Schuler with the stop.
Gain of six. Second and 18.
And once again, the defense really just toying with Thomas Cirk and the offense. They show so much pressure up the middle, on the edges, and then at the last second start bailing guys out to really confuse the blocking scheme and confuse the receivers in their routes.
Receiver screen. Ron Grayson. Boy, the Mountaineers just blow that thing up.
Oh, yeah. Avery was right there on the tackle.
Oh, yes, Avery with the stop.
They're so good at just recognizing tendencies. Very well-coached defense. Not only are they fast and physical, but they are smart. They understand where they can be attacked. And like I said, when they read and react to something, they're very sure tacklers.
Third and 16. Pirates are 1-for-4 so far on third down. The mind they converted a third and 15 in the first quarter. Cirk, rolling right, throws that one up. Almost intercepted. He's looking for Quay Johnson.
Well, would you believe it? That's the spur position, Kaiser White. We talk about how versatile he is. He comes flying in as a deep cover safety on that play. Now, keep in mind, he is used as a utility guy. He can be a linebacker on the outside. You'll often see him in the box or blitzing off the edge, but they also trust him as a deep safety to make plays like that.
Austin Barnes doing the punting. Marcus Sims runs up, makes the catch. That is on 19. Mountaineer offense, they have been perfect. Every time they've touched the football, they've come up with a score.
Well, it's been a perfect afternoon for this West Virginia offense led by Will Greer. Three possessions, three touchdowns. And when you watch this guy play, it's a little bit like backyard football. He likes to get outside the pocket, but the thing that I really enjoy about him today is his accuracy. He's been so accurate on the slants, the fade pass, the deep ball, even slightly underthrown, but hits the mark. He has a plethora of receivers that he uses and a good backfield of running backs. Perfect balance for this offense. Like I said, three scores in three possessions.
Here's another one, Martell Petaway, who checks in, the sophomore out of Detroit. Jordan Williams makes the tackle. Rear, looking left. Got a man over the middle, it's Petaway. And he's got a first down.
At some point in time, East Carolina's defense is going to have to start blitzing, bringing some pressure. That was the third read that they threw down to Petaway on the check down. He can't have that much time to throw the ball.
Greer keeps this one. He's close to a first down marker. Bobby Folt with the stop.
It's not exactly something the coaches really want to see there is Will Greer running the football. He's a competitor now. They said they don't want to see him run five or eight or nine times. A couple times a game, maybe, but they really want to limit how many times he gets hit.
Boy, Bettaway ran into the entire Pirate defense. Raekwon Purvis was the first man there. Plugged that one up. Third down and two now for the Pirates. That was quick. It's complete. And Gary Jennings.
And this Temple already has this defense tired. It was third and two, and they're having the corners play so far off. I got to imagine that's just the corners being tired. You got to understand the situations. It only takes a 2 to 3 yard route, and that ball's coming out quick for them to pick up the third down conversion.
Mountaineers substituting guys in. That's Petaway and Crawford. Crawford in motion. Greer, he's looking downfield. He's got a man, touchdown! Marcus Sims, welcome back to the lineup. 52 yards. Will Greer to Marcus Sims.
Well, they talked about his straight line speed. They wanted to get the ball into Marcus Sims' hands to see what he can do. And he just outruns the coverage.
Here's Mike Molina. Once again, Mountaineer offense. Six plays, 81 yards. Took him a minute 59. Marcus Sims missed the season opener, but making his presence known here in the home opener. 28-3, West Virginia.
Welcome back to Morgantown. It is 28-3 West Virginia over East Carolina. And it was a 52-yard catch. The Marcus Sims watched this pure speed and nothing right here. There is no safety help. One of the fastest guys on the field, and Marcus Sims one-on-one with the corner on the outside. Corner has good leverage, expecting some sort of help on the middle. And he just delivers a strike from Will Greer and the catch from Sims and some nice fancy footwork there on the celebration.
Big plays. They're really happy to have Sims back in the lineup. Mountaineers now five plays and 20 plus more yards here. That was one of the things that Coach Montgomery said they couldn't afford, is giving up these big splash plays, chunk plays. He said, I need to see my quarterback show up. Evan Stanley, the kick. Here's Chris Love. His own 25. Let's get a game break here. Here's Sam Farber. Yeah, you know something about those Wildcats.
I do. That's going to be a battle of two really good defenses, two teams that are coached really well. They don't make a lot of mistakes. That'll be a fun one in November.
Sir, that one intercepted. Kaiser White with the pick.
When I talk about the utility aspect of Kaiser White, he's an underneath buzz defender. What we mean by that, you'll see him all the way out here run underneath this. There he is. His responsibility is to buzz underneath anything short in the flat with the corner over the top. He reads it perfectly, executes it perfectly. It's a lot of ground to cover, and he does it with his eyes back to the quarterback. And he shows off and flashes his wide receiver hands that he's got. He's got two older brothers that have pretty good hands.
Ron is already... and a touchdown catch. Older brother Kevin, of course, the starting receiver for the Bears, who's All-American here. Greer under pressure, escapes, rolls right, and dragged down. And listen, they're going to throw that flag down. And that's kind of like a horse collar. There is an emphasis on that, Ben.
Yeah, it's absolutely a horse collar. And there's a difference in this year. I don't think it pertains to this particular play. As he gets an action right around the collar, but they're extending that horse collar area down to the nameplate.
Nameplate, yep.
Personal foul.
That's a face mask.
Face mask, number 56 of the defense. After this, it's two goals on that at first down.
Either way, it's a dangerous play. I like the hustle. I like the spirit. But you, as a defender, you have to be careful and cognizant of where you're putting your hands. And I don't think Will Greer did anything right there to adjust his body that you could give the defender any sort of slack. He's just got to play with better discipline on the tackle.
Tyree Owens. Crawford in the backfield alongside Greer. He gets the carry. Cuts it up. Picks up about five. Tim Irvin there with the stop. And Irvin, the nephew, Hall of Famer Michael Irvin. And looking for Seals. Touchdown. Not near.
I mentioned it earlier, it's just the accuracy that's impressed me with Will Greer. As you see, just a one-on-one battle with David Sills on the outside, a little shake and bake, goes for that back corner pylon to create that separation, and once again, Will Greer sees it perfectly, delivers a nice ball. They wanted to see him get better at putting air underneath the ball so his receivers could go and get it. It seems like that week of work and preparation has really paid off.
The point's good, and the Mountaineers are rolling thanks to this interception by Kaiser White. That led to Greer, Seals, West Virginia up 32 here in the first half. David Seals, touchdown catch. Will Greer, look at three plays, 31 yards, took him less than a minute.
I hate to say it, and no disrespect to East Carolina, but that drive was too easy. That was just way too easy. They got the one-on-one outside with Sills. Makes a nice little move. Greer puts it perfectly on the fade to that back corner.
Let's go, Trey, make a play. Let's
it
go.
It is shaped to be a blowout already here midway through the second quarter.
Stanley with the kick. Let's talk about how Davis Sills got here to West Virginia. Supposed to be a quarterback prodigy. Story goes, Lane Kiffin saw him in seventh grade, offered him a scholarship to USC. Broke his ankle his senior year of high school, decommitted to USC and came here to West Virginia. Started off as the scout team quarterback, but really with the defensive coordinator, Tony Gibbs, and said, listen, you got to play wide receiver. But he wanted to fulfill that dream of quarterback, went to a JUCO and ended up coming back. Talking to Dana Holgerson, said, look, I want to come back. And he has really excelled as a wide receiver.
Well, and he and Dana had a nice relationship through the recruiting process, has known him for a while, and said, hey, I respect your decision to go all the way out to California to try your hand at playing quarterback. And he really thinks that that's what's made him such a good receiver now, is he's kind of scratched that itch. He realized that, all right, maybe I'm not a quarterback at the D1 level. I'll come back. I'll be more committed to play wide receiver. And he's shaping it to be another good wide receiver and a great weapon on the outside for Will Greer.
Another third down for the Pirates. Third and four. Four wides for Thomas Serp. That's up top. Wade Johnson, and he drops it. Toyus Avery.
Toyus has had a real nice game so far. Just watch the trigger. He knows right now that in his responsibility, man-to-man coverage, he's going to play off, allow himself to have some space to react. He sees the quick out by the number two receiver, and he just puts his foot in the ground and attacks. And that's the one thing when you put on the tape of West Virginia, these secondary guys, along with all the other guys, but especially the secondary, they will come downhill and hit you.
Austin Barnes punting it away to Marcus Sims. And he is leveled. We got a flag on the play.
Yeah, leveled illegally. I think that's a no-brainer, helmet to helmet.
Joe Carter. Came down and delivered the hit.
Personal foul targeting number 30, the kicking team. 15-yard penalty, first down, the play's under review.
You take another look at this one, and they're going to review it.
Well, I tell you what, in real time, it looked like it was a pretty obvious helmet-to-helmet. The thing that you'll see, you'll notice his head dip. He hits with the crown of his helmet. Big collision. The timing was right. I applaud his effort and his timing. Wants to make a big play on special teams, but you have to be coached, and it has to be now just a natural thing to dip and get low.
Let's go to our rules expert in Los Angeles, Mike Pereira. Mike, what do you think?
Yeah, I think they stay with this as targeting, and the reason being is that the receiver of the punt is considered defenseless. So you cannot go to the head or neck area with your helmet, your forearm, your shoulder, whatever it is. And here you have helmet-to-helmet contact. And, you know, it's hard as the defender, you know, to try to make the play, but you've got to lower your target area.
So you're right about that. The official review, its call stands, and now you see Carter, he's got a lead because of the rules we're targeting. He is ejected from the game. 35-3. That's our score here in the second quarter. Welcome back. 35-3 is our score. Coming up, State Farm Halftime Show. Rob Stone, Dave Wonstedt, Matt Leiner, Robert Smith, all from Los Angeles. What's that big one tonight? Oklahoma, Ohio State from the Shoe. Justin Crawford gets the carry. How about this? Comes all the way back to the right. Picks up about five. At nothing, gets a gain of five.
Yeah, he's so sneaky and slithery. He can fit through a lot of, like, tight creases and tight lanes. You saw the stiff arm. This guy really possesses a lot of positive things as a running back.
Greer, kept it. Slides down. That was his wise choice.
Yeah, Devon Sutton, number 42, who plays that pirate position in this 4-2-5 defense. He was waiting right there, and Will, a little broken play, looked like they were going for a shovel pass. And Sutton was right there, and Greer wisely says, I'm not going to take a hit from you.
These guys have been perfect on third down. Mountaineers have 2 for 2. Getting a third and 9. And that one's complete to Caron White.
Well, that play right there just shows you why it's so tough to play against a guy like Will Greer. Decent rush, decent pressure, gets him out on the right side as he's scrambling. Then he throws as he's on the run. Feet weren't set, just using all arm strength. He delivers a nice ball accurately to Caron White as he sits down in that zone. So it's so hard not only to get pressure on him, but to keep him inside the pocket, and he's going to make throws like that all game.
That one. Skip that one. Looking to Marcus Sims. Once again, another third down for the Mountaineers. Third and 6. Kennedy McCoy will check in. He's in the backfield. Justin Crawford will get a blow. Again, Caron White. Makes another catch, another first down. Mountaineers still perfect when it comes to third down opportunities.
Well, he stared him down. He knew exactly where to go with the ball right there, but it was the timing of the route. He threw it right as Caron made his break towards the outside. No chance for the defender.
Greer drops it, picks it up, throws it.
No, he didn't.
Yes, he did, but he's out of bounds.
Marcus Sims. Like I said, he does not care if anybody's covered. He's going to throw it up. Snap was fine. He just bobbles it, picks it up, and just chucks it outside. And you know what? I'll just make my guys go up and make a play and try to make me right.
Kobe Gore jumped. He's like, how did that get over me?
Ruling on the field is an incomplete catch. Play's under review.
I'm going to take another look at it.
What exactly are they looking for here? Take another look here. Here's the end of the catch. Never had possession.
An incomplete pass is confirmed. It'll be second down.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
I guess they thought. I guess they thought maybe he had the ball there for a second.
Much emphasis as it is on what is the catch, isn't the catch. I mean, that was, yeah. To me, that one was simple.
Due diligence, man. They just want to make sure they're getting the right call.
What a return for Marcus Sims out of Sandy Spring, Maryland. Steps up, throws it in and out of the hands of Davis Sills.
Boy, that should have been a catch, too. Again, tight coverage. Greer rolling to his right, all arm strength, no lower body set or platform. And he puts it right on the money. Sills has got to come up with that. Had two drops last week against Virginia Tech. There's a number of drops across the board at wide receiver. He's got to make that play.
So far, Mountaineers and Greer, 4 for 4 here on third down. Greer's going for 43 yards here on third down. That play blown up. Jordan Williams delivered the hit to Caron White.
Well, it's Kendall Futrell, the left defensive end for East Carolina, that had the free rush. The miscommunication, the blocking scheme. He comes flying down the edge and actually provides the pressure. Greer has to make a quick throw, a little inaccurate. Running back was not ready.
Here's Mike Molina. This is from 44 yards out. His career high is 50. And that is no good.
Well, a little positivity now for East Carolina. They got a stop defensively. Got some decent pressure on Greer on that drive. The drop pass by Sills kind of helps him out. Take another look at the missed field goal. Wide left for Molina.
You know Coach Ogerson is not going to like that. As you talked about, he's given up the play calling duties. He's now in charge of special teams. Darrell Scott has checked in the backfield for the Pirates. Sir, that was intended for Scott. He dropped it.
It might have been fine that he dropped that pass. I think Al-Rashid Benton was sitting right in the middle of the field in a soft little zone, was keying the check down the whole time, broke on the pass, and I think he was going to light him up once he caught the ball.
Second and 10 for the Pirates. Down the sideline. Caught by Devin Grayson. Ron Grayson here makes the catch. That's inside Mountaineer territory.
Well, that was impressive. He was covered all the way down the field. Cirque puts it on him to go make the play. and threads the needle with the safety coming across. Corey Winfield, unbelievable catch.
36 yards. Dump off Darrell Scott. Never really had possession of that one.
Well, you've seen a defensive philosophy shift these last few drives for West Virginia. A lot more just straight zone, dropping eight, only rushing three, allowing four, even five defenders in that short underneath zone and saying, hey, we're going to challenge you on the outside. You got to fit in a tight window, and if you check it down, we're going to have our linebackers come up and hit you.
Second and 10. Sir. He's looking for Grayson again. Corey Winfield.
Oh, just as I say that, Tony Gibson, defensive coordinator, dials up a blitz. Again, trusts his corners on the outside to go man-to-man to make those plays. And Cirque knows he has to get the ball out as quick as possible because that heat can be coming from anywhere.
Pirates with trips up top. Looking at a third and 10. Down the seam. Ooh, what a lick. DeAndre Farrier.
Let's ask you, Henry, in that two-deep zone, you got Al-Rashid Benton running up the middle of the field and covered as the middle linebacker, knowing that he has deep safety help, the two safeties back there, and they just plant and drive on that ball. And I like the fact that he went low on that hit, understanding that he does not want to get a target or a foul on a defenseless receiver. He goes low. It's a very legal hit by the safety.
Fourth down. Pirates obviously going to go for it here. Here comes the pressure. And that was intended for Jimmy Williams.
Well, they had what they're looking for. They max protect on the inside. They guessed right offensively. They pick up the blitz. You see the running back pick up the blitz. And the ball is just delivered slightly behind Jimmy Williams on the in route. So missed opportunity for the offense and for Cirk on that fourth down play.
Well, Thomas Cirk and the Pirates started 9 of 13, he did. But since then, he's gone just 1 for 9. Here's Crawford, up the middle, breaking tackles, first down. Corey Sargent makes the stop for the Pirates. Jennings, quick out.
Yeah, that last run play was indicative of what this offense can do. A lot of chunk yardage, and watching Crawford just kind of slide his way through the line of scrimmage is impressive to watch.
Crawford again up the middle. He's in Pirate territory now. Dropped at the 40.
I think part of the reason why East Carolina had such a hard time stopping the run last week, and they're having a hard time again this week, look how deep these linebackers are.
Crawford again. Right up the middle. Justin Crawford, he's got one man to beat. Touchdown, Mountaineers. 41 yards, Justin Crawford.
Well, like I just pointed out, East Carolina keeps their linebackers' depth so deep. And watch the hat on the hat with everybody. Wellman comes up the middle of the field as a lead blocker. Once again, it's power football when they want to run the football with West Virginia. We got a hat on the hat, and there's so many natural creases because the linebackers play so deep.
There is no foul on the play. West Virginia calls its first time out of the half. It's a 30-second timeout.
West Virginia calls the timeout. Justin Crawford is now just a yard away from 100 on the day. 12 carries, 99 yards.
Well, once again, look how deep these guys are. It allows the linemen to get hat on the hat, and then look at all the space. When they make first engagement with the fullback Wellman,
Crawford is already 3 or 4 yards past the line of scrimmage, and he sees those natural running lanes because of the depth of those linebackers. They have to get down at the line of scrimmage, especially now with the score that what it is. It's going to be 4-minute offense for West Virginia. We're just going to run the football and run this clock out the rest of the game.
Good job on the It's a hell of a
42-3. Score now. Justin Crawford with 99 yards. He had 106 last week against Virginia Tech on 13 carries.
He started running. Hey, that's a hell of a job.
Mountaineers at nearly 400 yards total offense.
Well, and I think the rest of the Big 12 has to be on alert when they watch these games. And I get that East Carolina is maybe not the foe that's the best comparable for some of the teams in the Big 12. But when you watch this offense of West Virginia, this is what they can do. They can beat you with the pass. We've seen Will Grier, you know, just put it on the money, extending plays with his legs, getting outside the pocket, hard guy to contain. They've got a bunch of big-time playmakers on the outside. And then if they get up on you a couple of scores, well, now they can run the ball. Now they can get big guys in the backfield. They find a lot of balance. They keep a lot of defenses on their heels because you have no idea what to expect from this offense.
Bailey with the kick. Chris Love from his own 5. Right on it. The 20. Let's get another game break from Sam Farber. All right, Sam, thank you. Here comes Thomas Sirk, East Carolina. Shane Howe. In the backfield. He gets the carry. Good open field tackle there by Toyus Avery.
You bring a good point about just the tackling for West Virginia. We talked to the coaches just about their physicality, and he said, I was blown away when he told us this. 600 reps in training camp of live tackling that they do at West Virginia. That's an unbelievable amount of tackling. And where a lot of universities are going away from contact in training camp, West Virginia is still going old school. They want these guys to be prepared for contact. They want these guys to play with contact. It helps the offense out. It helps Crawford, the running backs, understand, you know, to make full-speed cuts, knowing that they're going to get hit. But 600 reps of live tackling, and you can see how it is on game day. These guys are not ready to contact. It's just like a practice. They come downhill. They hit you in the mouth. And even on the days in season, it's still full-speed thud to the ball. So these guys are going full-speed all the time, and it really shows on Saturdays.
Well, Tony Gibson, the defensive coordinator, has done a phenomenal job here. A couple of guys went in the NFL draft last season, 4 guys the year before, total of 6 over the past couple of years. Now, spinning off. Talking about tackling. Spinning off some tacklers there.
Gets a first down. I want to stop praising them. I say, hey, they're great tacklers. And then the very next play, there's 2 missed tackles. But nice job of the spin and all that by Dye. Doing a good job. Excuse me. That's Hussein Howe of using everybody's leverage against them and just spinning off and making some plays, picking up a first down. So challenging my praise of this West Virginia defense.
Howe, the sophomore out of Jacksonville, Florida. He gets it again. Out past the 45. Al Rashid Benton.
You know, it is interesting. I know you're down 42-3 and it's only the first half, but I would think in these situations offensively you could work on sort of your 2-minute offense. Let's play with a sense of urgency. We're gonna be in games later on in the season where we need to practice this stuff. You know, let's work on, you know, not bleeding the clock out right now and running the football. Let's work on some 2-minute stuff. Get your guys down the field, see if you have some explosive plays.
2nd and 4. Here comes the blitz. Under pressure. Kaiser White.
And again, it's Kaiser who really is all over the field. Had an interception earlier in the game.
Looks like DeAndre Farrier is the pirate down. Warrior out of Orlando. He's a sophomore.
Boy, he seems to be in an awful lot of pain as they look like they're working on lower body, maybe his right calf. What I was saying about Kaiser White, you know, we talked about him before the game, just what everything that he can do is we see good news for Ferrier as he gets up. We'll take a look at him right here, number one in the middle of your screen. That looks like his foot got caught right underneath him and stuck into the turf, and his momentum kind of kept him going forward in the route.
Yeah, that right leg. Third and four now for the Pirates from their own 45.
Third and four for East Carolina.
Two of eight thus far. Quay Johnson in motion. Devon Grayson is up with the catch.
Good design there. They motion the number two receiver. It tells Cirque that they're in man-to-man and frees up the side of the offense and to realize he has man-to-man coverage on the outside. He can trust his receiver to win, which he did, and they pick up a first down.
Minute 20 until the half. Cirque. Caught. Quay Johnson.
Boy, Avery, he was right there. Here's Avery. Watch him come down, break on this play. Sticks his foot in the ground, but the delivery is fast. It's effective. It's on point. And Quay Johnson goes up and snatches that ball out of the air, but a nice break by Avery to almost break that thing up.
Minute until the half. Pressure. Sir, looking up top. And throws an interception.
Is that another for Kaiser?
Kaiser White.
He provided some pressure early on in the series. A blitz off the edge. And he gets a second interception. Is it just a miscommunication on the outside? Quay Johnson was running one route. Cirque thought he was going to make a break to the outside. And Kaiser with the leverage on the outside. He just floats back and picks off that ball. An easy interception on the miscommunication with the quarterback and receiver.
That's his second of the game. Keep in mind, coming up, it is the State Farm halftime show. These guys will preview that Oklahoma-Ohio State game. Feature on Jake Olson, UFC's blind long snapper, who was a special teams player of the week. What a great story.
What an incredible story. Started all the way back with Pete Carroll.
Under a minute. Crawford gets the carry. Crawford's over 100 yards rushing now.
There's really just nothing standing in the way defensively for East Carolina. Again, they're just the big boys for West Virginia up front are getting initial contact, pushing the guys off the line of scrimmage, and then they're allowing the linemen to get all the way up.
Open. Is David Seals, and he can walk into the end zone. Busted coverage, another touchdown for the Mountaineers. How does that happen?
Well, I think they just lulled them to sleep with the run game. Crawford busts one off the last series for a touchdown. Has another 10-yard pickup on the first play, and you'll see Sills on the outside. Again, it's the setup that looks like a screen pass. Everybody bites. And Will Greer, the deep ball has been beautiful for him today.
Another score.
With 30 seconds.
Will Greer has thrown for over 300 yards, 329.
Last week it was Gary Jennings with the huge game against Virginia Tech. And today, right now, it's David Sills taking over in the first half of this game.
Will Greer, first West Virginia quarterback to 4 TD passes in a half since Geno Smith did it back in 2012, and Sills has got two of them.
Again, a lot to be excited about with this offense, and with Will Greer, he has a tremendous offense. The players love and respect him. You know, he was here all of last year as he transferred in from Florida, had a whole year just to get to know everybody, for everybody to get to know him. And now that he's in charge, he has really taken off with the new offensive coordinator, Dick Spavital, calling the plays in place of Dana Holgorsen this year. And right now, they have not missed a beat. They are explosive. They can run when they want to run. And if Greer is that accurate on his deep balls, you better watch out in Week 12.
Chris Love took a touchback here. And boy, what a half it has been for the Mountaineer offense. Will Greer throwing touchdowns. That one right around White and Marcus Sims. And, of course, the running game got involved. First it was Crawford, then it was McCoy. Four TDs on the night for Greer thus far. Sills has got two of those. In fact, the first drive for the Mountaineers went 2 minutes and 16 seconds. That was the longest they've had so far in this game.
Well, and it's all been complimentary plays. You know, they set everything up. They have a play that looks just like a play before, but they do something different out of it. So that particular play, Sills gets wide open because they've been setting up this horizontal passing game with the receivers, these screen passes where an outside receiver goes to block one of the defenders and they run a screen pass. Well, let's use the same formation, the same look, the same body language, but let's run something different. We'll fake the block and then we'll go long on a nine route. And that's what's been happening all game long. So Jake Spavital calling plays now in place of Dana Holgorsen has done such a good job of making things all look the same, but then running plays differently outside of it.
Well, the Mountaineers put up a 20 spot in the first quarter and another 20 spot in the second quarter. Our halftime score here at Morgantown, West Virginia 49, East Carolina 3. We'll get you to Los Angeles for the State Farm Halftime Show right after this break. Call this the gold rush game, but it's been more like a bum rush here in the first half as the Mountaineers of West Virginia up 49-3 as we begin the second half. Brian Custer alongside Ben Lieber. What are your thoughts of what you saw in the first half?
Sadly, it's kind of what we thought. You know, going to this game, East Carolina really struggled last week against James Madison, and this is a much better team than James Madison. And West Virginia, once again, showing the balance, throwing the ball down the field, running the football with effectiveness. It's just been all West Virginia the first half.
There were a couple of guys you highlighted at the top of the broadcast, and really they have shown up and shown out here for West Virginia. Let's start with their quarterback, Will Greer.
Yeah, he was a little sluggish last week against Virginia Tech, settled down in the second half, and now comes out on fire in this game. You know, I'm really impressed with just his downfield accuracy, the way he's controlling this offense, a lot of the deep balls, which the coaches said, hey, we want him to get better at throwing the deep ball and being more accurate and on time, and he's been all of that today.
329 yards passing, four TDs for Will Greer. Defensively, Kaiser White.
Yeah, we talked about Kaiser. He's pretty much the utility player for this defense. He's all over the field. Only three tackles, one pressure, and two interceptions. He has been a force for this defense. He will continue to be a force for this defense throughout the rest of the season. He's a special player to watch.
Let's take a look at the halftime and first half stats brought to you by Dave Buster. Hey, look at the average per play. Basically 10 yards there by West Virginia. Again, the turnovers, they were a problem for the Pirates in their season opener. They're a problem so far today, a couple of them. Two picks by Tom Stark. Dana Holgerson. His squad, here comes Thomas Cirque again. He's the transfer from Duke, hitting the start. Gardner Minshew started the season opener for the Pirates. Got pulled right before the half. Cirque replaced him. So far, Cirque just 12 of 26 for 133 yards. Two interceptions. The Pirates will get the football here to start the second half. Chris Love from his own two. Brought down at the 25. Take a look at the offensive leaders here for the Pirates. Hussein Howe came in. Ran the ball 34 yards. Jimmy Williams had four catches for 53. Most of those came in the first quarter.
Well, there have been times where I think you've kind of been impressed by what Cirque can do. They've diagnosed some of the disguise defensively for West Virginia. They've figured some things out. They've looked effective at times. He's thrown some nice balls, thrown some balls with velocity down the field. I think there's components there to have a good offense. They just have to put things together. Offensive line has to come together. They have gel. They've moved some guys around from last week to this week. They're young at center. They're young at right guard. It's going to take, you know, a game or two for these guys to sort of figure out and get into rhythm and get used to each other. And, you know, they played a really good team last week in James Madison. They're tough, defending national champs at the FCS level. So they're a good football team. They have West Virginia this week. They have Virginia Tech next week. So they don't get a lot of break to kind of figure some stuff out. But I think they have the components there to be a good offensive football team.
Tayshaun Dye rumbles up the middle for a first down. Right at midfield. Dye again. He's in Mountaineer territory. Here's Kaiser White again.
Well, there are a lot of areas, as I just spoke of, where this offense for East Carolina has to get better. But what has to really improve dramatically and quickly is the run game. Only 80 yards rushing last week. You know, only 55, you know, at the half for this team this week. They have to get the run game going. They want to see what Dye could do as the starter. He's coming here tonight, been largely ineffective. But if they want to have any sort of balance, they have to run the football a little bit better.
Look how wide open Tayshaun Dye is, and you don't get a completion here. You got to catch that football.
Yeah, you definitely have to catch the football. It's put, you know, you can't get any better. It's thrown basically right at his eyes, and he takes his concentration off. Not sure what he was looking at. Not sure if he was shielded a little bit by the offensive lineman, but he has to make that catch.
Hussein Howe checks in. Blitz. That's caught. Gracie breaks the tackle. He's down at the 30.
There's been a number of times this game where West Virginia has blitzed like they do again here with Kaiser White. You see him come and blitz right there and take on the offensive tackle. And it leaves the corners, Hakeem Bailey and others, Corey Winfield along with him, throughout the game, singled up one-on-one on the outside. There's been several times where East Carolina receivers have won those battles.
This is how. Up the middle. Ran into a wall of Mountaineers. Reese Donahue. First, make the stop.
So we wondered at halftime what was going to happen with West Virginia, what they're going to do personnel-wise. You're up 46 points. You still have a full half to play, but you start pulling guys back. You put the second team guys in there, and right now they elected to start the second half with their starters on defense.
Turk looking up top to Jimmy Williams. He was in a battle with Mike Daniels.
Yeah,
man. This was a true battle down the field. One-on-one once again, singled up. Tries to get his hands on. Watch the finish at the end of this play from Daniels. He actually tries to turn and make a play on that football, but a nice battle out there one-on-one. Jimmy Williams, one of their best receivers, a go-to guy. You might see him again here on third down.
Third and eight. Pirates 4-10 on third down. Here comes pressure. Search steps up, rolls right. And that was underthrown to Jimmy Williams, but there's a flag.
I think they're going to get Mike Daniels again. And really, there's no reason why Daniels needs to even put his hands on him. He felt the route. He felt the pass. He turned around.
Pass interference number 81 of the offense.
Well, they're going to get Jimmy Williams.
He's up the play. Will be fourth down.
How about that? It looks like Williams grabbed on the jersey.
Once again, another blitz. Daniels does a good job of reading and diagnosing.
Michael, I need an explanation.
Whoa, come on! How about that? You're going for the football. You're grabbing on the jersey of the defender.
Like you said the play before, it's a battle out there between those two.
There's no way. There's no way.
There's the head coach, Scotty Montgomery, in his second year. Clearly not happy with the call.
He's going to try his kicking game here. Jake Verity. He's a 45-yarder from Verity. And he got it. Just like their first offensive possession of the game, the Pirates get a field goal. That pass interference call there hurt them. Pirates come up with three. 49-6 our score in the third quarter. FS1 College Football is sponsored by Dave and Buster. Third quarter. Mountaineers up 49-6.
Wasn't a bad opening drive for East Carolina. Got 3 points out of it. See if they can chip away at this lead that West Virginia has.
Slowly but surely.
Slowly but surely.
Caleb Pratt kicked things away for the Pirates. Marcus Sims. Is nine. Cuts back. 30. Makes a move across the 40. Boy, he is excited. You see why the coach was so excited to have him back in the lineup. Take a look at some of the offensive leaders. Mountaineers and what they've done here thus far. Greer's thrown for 329. He's got four touchdown passes. Justin Crawford had 106 yards rushing in the season opener. He's got 110 so far. David Sills got two touchdown catches as well. Crawford alongside Greer in the backfield. Gets the carry. He goes right up the middle. Mervin with the stop. Four touchdown passes. First out of the Mountaineer quarterback's done. That is Geno Smith. He's now playing in New York. Back up in the Giants.
You talk about this offensive production, and you got to credit Jake Spavital, the offensive coordinator, once again taking over for Dana Holgorsen as the play caller. This is his second game doing that, and it's been balance. It's been deep shots. It's been explosion on the outside. You get Justin Crawford running up the middle. Power run game. It's been a nice mix and a balance and a good job.
Number 73, the offense. 10-yard penalty, third down.
Doing a good job of disguising a lot of their stuff. Complementary formations, complementary routes. We take a look at Spavital there.
Josh Seals calls for that holding. third and 11 for the Mountaineers. Greer steps up. Another flag on the play. He's brought down.
Looks like we're going to get another holding call. It's West Virginia offensive line.
Number 79, the offense. Penalties decline. Fourth down.
Matt Jones, the sophomore out of Hubbard, Ohio.
You know, he has interesting shoes to fill. Three-year starter, Tyler Orlowski, who's a center here for a long time, played a lot of games at West Virginia. So steady on that offensive line, and Matt's got to kind of replace his shoes.
This is Irvin. Catches the punt from his own 21. Well, we're in Morgantown. That means take me home, country roads. West Virginia. Welcome back, Ray Morgantown. The home opener for the West Virginia Mountaineers. It's their annual Gold Rush game. Two of these Gold Rush games. Pirates with the football from their own 21. They go four wide. Thomas Sirk keeps it right up the middle. Slides for a first down.
Well, those are the plays that we actually expected to begin the game. The coaches even told us, hey, we want to get Thomas sort of in rhythm, and the way we get him in the rhythm, let's run the football with him. He's a dual threat guy. He doesn't mind getting hit. Toughness is one of his best attributes. And we didn't see much of that in the first quarter, and now we're starting to see a little bit more of a power run game to quarterback.
Die in motion. That's complete. Davon Grayson.
I feel like maybe not with the play calls, but just with body language, that this West Virginia defense is taking their foot off the pedal just a little bit. Not quite playing with the tempo and ferocity that they played with in the first half, and I get it. The score is what it is, but if you're on the field, you got to go out there and execute and play with some passion.
This is Dye. He bangs his way into Mountaineer territory. Now Rashid Benton makes the stop. Guy now has 37 yards rushing at 42. Die again, right side, cuts back. Back to the left. 25, pushed out of bounds. Good piece of running. Dylan Tonkery pushed him out of bounds after that 25-yard pickup by Tyshawn Dye.
Well, just as I was talking about, there seems to be a little lack of effort for this West Virginia defense. Good job by the offensive line getting a hat on a hat, a body on a body, a missed tackle, and you see a little bit of the dynamic ability from Dye that the coaches have talked about.
Sir, looking for Williams. Back in the end zone. They say incomplete.
But it was awfully close. It was about a half a yard too far outside. He could not get his foot down, but a nice little out and up by Jimmy Williams. That was almost a perfect executed play. As you see, just about a half a foot outside on the out of bounds, and Williams could not corral it and get his 1 foot in bounds.
He had a step on Akeem Bailey. 3 seconds on the play clock. I don't know they're going to get it off.
Yeah.
Pirates get the timeout. They're knocking on the door, looking to score. We're in the third quarter. They're down 49-6. Pirates at the West Virginia 22. Second possession here in the second half. Trying to put some more points on the board. Surf keeps it. Pickup of about three.
Well, again, you saw it earlier in this drive. They're trying to get the power run game with the quarterback more involved in the second half. Using polars, guards, centers coming across the line. Traditional power football. Get the extra blocker with the quarterback running the ball. The good Ducks tracking that down from a defensive front standpoint and chasing it down.
Third and seven. Mountaineers show pressure. And they're coming. Sir throws. Got a man. Touchdown. Jimmy Williams. Sirk took a big hit.
Well, he took a huge hit. This is the thing that they like about this guy is watch the hot pocket. He'll stay right in there. He knows he's going to get hit right there. Al-Rashid Benton, one of their biggest and best linebackers, is blitzing through that B-gap, puts a hit on him, but he's still able to stay in the pocket and find Jimmy Williams for the touchdown. It's that toughness that they love about Thomas Sirk.
Jake Verity. With the extra point, and the Pirates, their first touchdown of the day. Sir to Williams. 49-13 to score here in the third. Welcome back as they take a look at Thomas Sirk there, being looked over by the staff. Touchdown pass to Jimmy Williams. Take a little look at this hit there, Ben.
Well, you can see Benton just blitzing up the A-gap. And takes a nice little shot. He was slow to get up. And then we saw all through the break that somebody from the medical staff was tending to him, asking a lot of questions. You know, he's got the flak jacket and the rib protector on, but not a whole lot of talking about a body part or anything like that, but a lot of just question and answer as we see the onside kick.
How about that? Caleb Pratt,
and he got it
with the onside kick and recovers it.
Ooh,
close.
That's awfully close.
Ooh, that's close. Go 10 yards. Let's see.
It's one thing I noticed all game long is the front line for West Virginia before the ball was kicked was drifting back, not waiting for the kick. So the opportunity has been there all game.
Going on the field, the ball was illegally touched by the kicking team member before it went 10 yards. Therefore, it will be West Virginia's ball to spot illegal touches to 44 first down.
Well, they had the look, they had the kick and everything that they wanted. It's just that the kicker got a little bit too antsy. Watch the guys on the front line all drifting back. Drifting, drifting, drifting. It's there.
Yeah.
He just has to wait.
That's it. You're right. They had to get right there to the 45. You can see he basically grabbed it at that 44.
It was close, yes, too.
It was close. Kennedy McCoy in the backfield alongside Greer. He gets the carry. Bangs forward for a pickup of five.
You know, sort of the unsung hero of this offense at times is Elijah Wellman, number 28. You'll see him lined up in the backfield a lot of times as the traditional H-back / fullback. And his job primarily, as we see a whole bunch of flags, is to be that lead blocker, even though he's weight-wise at 6'1", 240, not a traditionally sized fullback, but that's his job and that's his task, and he does a really good job of doing that.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 56 of the defense, throwing the runner to the ground. 15-yard penalty automatic, first down.
Tyree Owens, no, he had that face mask penalty in the first half.
Yeah, this is one of their, one of many, as we'll take a look here at 56. Got him in the grasp. That's a little bit more on 42, Devon Sutton, than anything else.
Hitman's complete. Elijah Wellman. Listen, you see, you've been doing blocking all day long. Give the big fella something.
Yeah, got to give him some love. You've been blocking your tail off all game long. We're going to do a little play action fake, have you split out as a number two and hit you up the seam.
Innings, a quick out.
You know, they've been so successful throughout this game, getting in this deep red zone area, just throwing those fade balls, which, you know, a low percentage pass, but they've been pretty successful. I expect, you know, maybe go to the well one more time. You're on the left hash. You'll have a lot of room to play with on the right side of the field. So maybe let Sills, the big receiver at 6'4", who's had a heck of a ball game, go up and try to make another play. Sills, as you see, he's going to go up as the X receiver on the far left, up against the boundary.
From the pistol is Greer. That's McCoy.
Kennedy McCoy, the ball carrier.
Third and goal for the Mountaineers.
Well, like I talked about earlier with the complementary formations and plays, they go full house backfield. They had the same formation earlier in the game. They threw a fade, and this time they elect to run it, keeping the defense off balance. And here's a little funky formation that they like to run as well.
Greer looking for Seals. Got it. Touchdown. His third.
Well, it was a little pivot route on the outside. Sills is going to run in. You'll see him at the top of the screen, stick his foot in the ground, come right back out. And he has to turn like that so he can always keep his eyes on the quarterback, because that ball is going to come out right as he breaks. So good job of selling it on the inside, sticking his foot in the ground, and getting the ball from Will Greer.
Extra point by Mike Molina is good. The Mountaineers. Look, even Mr. Mountaineers had enough.
He's passed it off to one of the military guys down there. He's like, I'm done doing push-ups.
He said, my buys and tries are burning. He's passing it over to our great military.
I don't think he wants to do it either. Like 56 is a lot.
Yeah, exactly.
I gotta get right. I think he's waiting for the right song.
Oh, man.
I believe in you, man. You can do it.
Yeah, really. There he is. Look.
He's not even going all the way down.
No, he's not. Look at this. Look, he's
first quarter, he was getting chest all the way down. Now in the third quarter, he's like, nah, I'm just, yeah.
55. Oh, God, I can't get these in. Oh, God.
Doesn't help that he's wearing the least breathable material. Hey, why don't you go put some all leather on and go stand in the sun and do push-ups?
David Sills now with 5 TDs here in 2 games. And basically just 2 in his career before the season opener. And it's Haley doing the kicking. Chris Love's back deep. Short. That's you. Well, start your NFL Sunday.
Seattle at Green Bay.
Yeah.
Be a big one.
How about Dallas? The Giants in Dallas. Now they see Ezekiel Elliott's going to be playing basically the entire season. new quarterback for the Pirates. Carry, Gardner Minshew is now checked in. You can see there, Thomas Cirque, he's going to head to the locker room after that big hit. It's on that touchdown pass.
Took that big hit. It was a great ball. Stood there in the pocket, took the shot from Benton on the blitz. And now we see Gardner Minshew, who started the season last week against James Madison, was pulled near the end of the first half. And because of injury, he'll get a chance to hopefully shine here in the second half.
Quick out there to Quay Johnson. He's a junior. He's out of Brandon, Mississippi. Third down for the Pirates.
You know, one of the things that the coaches wanted to see more of Minshew last week was don't be so quick to scramble. He gets out of the pocket sometimes a little too early. He needs to stay in there, let some routes develop, then throw the ball. But oftentimes he wants to get outside the pocket way too prematurely.
Crossing route is complete. Jimmy Williams.
Jimmy just found that soft little underneath zone. West Virginia, again, electing just to drop their second level defenders deep in a zone. And he just kind of settled in there on a quick crossing route.
And we got a flag on the play there.
Pass intended for degree five.
See that Davon Grayson, it kind of looked like he was going to do a like a start and stop. And
there is no foul for defensive pass interference on the play as the ball was ruled uncatchable.
Yeah, that's the right call. You saw Dana Holgerson say the same thing. Like, hey, I know my guy roughed him up, but that ball was thrown 15 yards out of bounds. Take a look at it one more time. Did you see the contact? It would have been pass interference had it been a catchable football.
Wow, in motion.
Wow, I think every ref would have flagged on that one.
They did.
Flag on the play.
It's like Michael Roach is signaling a hold there, the Pirates.
Holding number 55 of the offense. The penalties declined. Rough
to
play will be third down.
Garrett McGinn.
And McGinn is the guy that started at center last week. He was a guard last year. They moved him to center, and he just really struggled to snap the ball. Had five errant snaps, a couple of missed blocks, a couple of penalties. So they moved him back out to the guard, and he just had his first holding call and his first penalty of this game.
So third and 10. Minshew looking left and nearly intercepted. He was looking for Trayvon Brown.
Pass intended for number 88.
You know, one thing that this defense, these defensive backs do really well, you see when the ball's in the air, they're doing a good job of reading the receiver's eyes and hands, and they turn around trying to locate that football a lot, which allows them to make some plays on the ball, either PBUs or interceptions. Robinson does a good job there of, like I said, reading the eyes, getting his back turned, knocking that pass down.
Devin Bush back at his own 20, waiting for this punt. Comes up, makes the catch. Time now for a Dave and Buster's game break with Sam Farber.
All right, Brian.
A new quarterback here. Thank you, Sam. For the Mountaineers, Chris Chuganoff. Spill real Will Greer. Throwing for 352. Hands that one off to Kennedy McCoy. McCoy over that right side. Chuganoff is a sophomore. Skillman, New Jersey.
You get a whole new backfield. Trevon Wesco, now the lead blocker, and for Elijah Wellman.
Chuganoff looking left. That pass is complete. Dominic Maiden. Rel Green. Makes a stop. move the sticks. Jug it up. Quick out. Reggie Roberson.
Well, that was the play that they got earlier with David Sills on the fake screen to the receiver. The receiver runs a nine route, and they got Sills on for a touchdown. He tried it again. This time the defenders just go ahead and they're going to take the deep route, and we're going to go ahead and let you have that little underneath pass. And a little pump fake. They didn't bite on it. Then just make the safe throw out to the outside.
Kennedy McCoy again with the carry. Third and two now for the Mountaineers. McCoy falls forward. Pirate territory. Another first down.
Well, you might think that with the lead being what it is, 56 to 13, and you have some backups now, some second teamers coming into play offense, why is West Virginia still going up tempo? Why are they still going no huddle? Why are they still, you know, looks like they still have their foot on the gas? Well, your backups and your quarterback has to understand what it's like if they get in a real competitive game to run the offense that they want to run, still keep up the tempo, keep up the pace, so we can get real game reps and see how that feels.
Well, there's a sack. Chuganoff goes down. Keontae Anderson.
Yeah, haven't had much time to talk about this defense for East Carolina. As you see, Keontae right there on the outside. Just beasting the offensive lineman. Actually, that was Trevon Wesco, the H-back that came in. But Keontae is the guy that they're really excited about. He was a stand-up offensive, outside linebacker in the 3-4 last year. Now they switch to a more of a 4-2-5 as we see
Ricky Rogers nearly broke one in a flag late.
And we're going to get a low block on Reggie Roberson, the freshman from DeSoto, Texas, trying to make a block downfield. And I think he went low on the defender.
Personal foul. Try to defend this player, number 10 of the offense. Plays under review.
That's Reggie Roberson.
Take a look at 10.
What do you think?
It's a tough call. Man. I mean, it's anything to the head and neck area. He did not lead with his head, but a defenseless player, and that's what he's saying, defenseless player gets protection from anything that's up in the head and neck area. And I think that, to me, it was in the head and neck area. A good, strong play. I liked his effort. I like what he was thinking.
Yeah, I'm ready.
Well, I tell you what, let's go to Los Angeles and our rules expert, Mike Pereira. Mike, what do you think? Was that the shoulder or was that the head and neck area?
Well, you know, to me, this is a blindside block. That's what they're talking about. So that the player that is being blindsided blocked, being blocked from the side, he is protected from high hits, period. But it's not really the egregious one to me. It's shoulder to shoulder. Is the contact of the actual head forcible? This is not the kind of hit that I like to see a player get ejected for.
All right, Mike. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike.
We had one that, obviously, in the first half. Player got ejected from East Carolina, so that means that can't play the second half.
You know, I agree with, especially being an ex-defender myself, of having protections in place for guys getting hit like this where you're not ready. But at the same time, you know, it is football, and it's hard, really hard for these guys offensively, especially receivers, to get their target down, to lower their eyes, to hit in the legal space. That to me is just, you gotta have awareness as a defensive player as well. You have to know that there are guys around that are trying to peel you off. They're trying to block you. It's one of those effort plays that I hate to see guys get penalized for, because it's a rough sport. things are going to happen. I'll take targeting for 200, please, Alex.
They're still looking at this.
You know, guys, you look at this and you think if they're taking this long to make the decision, then to me it's not flagrant. Mm. And if they see that if they have to dissect it this long, again, I don't think the player should be ejected from the game.
And talk about the penalties here, Mike, with either call.
Yeah, of course, if they stay with the call now, he's ejected for the first half of the next game, too. And we'll see the discussion here. It makes me think they're going to pick it up.
Three-quarters up the play, first down for West Virginia at the 28-yard line.
Sounds like you're right on it, Mike.
Mr. Pereira, you are good, you.
Yeah, you're right on it.
Yeah, and again, I give the replay guys credit here. I mean, really, it should be something. When you're going to have a player have to sit out an entire half the next game, it needs to be flagrant. That's a big time frame to suspend the guy. So I like what they did here.
Thanks, Mike. We appreciate it. Martell Petaway checks in the backfield for the Mountaineers. Juggernaut. Looks left. That was intended for Drew Bowen.
Devon Sutton snuck in just the last second, just about picked that ball off. As Chuganoff, just like Wilger, having lots of time to go through his progression, started on the right side, went through 1-2, came back to the number three receiver, and Sutton just about picked it off.
That pass is complete. Dominic Maiden, or incomplete, drops it. Dominic Maiden. Third down and 10 now for the Mountaineers.
They bring big personnel in once again. Wesco checks into the game. They have that I formation backfield in the gun situation, so it looks like an I near, but with the quarterback in gun.
Juggernaut up top. Incomplete. Dominic Maiden again.
But Maiden, a couple rough two plays. You'll see him as a number one receiver on the top of the screen. Runs a nice route, plays off the leverage, and the ball was placed exactly where it needs to be placed. And I think he saw the safety standing there. He thought maybe he's going to get walloped. Short-armed it, alligator-armed it just a little bit, but you can't ask for anything more from Chuganoff as he put the ball right where it needed to be.
Here's Mike Molina, this one from 45 yards out. Missed one earlier. And he's missed another one. It's been a rough one for Mike Molina. Of course, with Hurricane Bush Gar Stadium, Morgantown, home opener for the Mountaineers, 56-13. Gardner Minshew, back to pass. Looks that one off to Tyshawn Dye. He's hit about 2 yards shy of a first down on Darius Qualls.
Yeah, we've seen Dye miss a really easy pass over the middle, but I like what he possesses as far as a ball carrier. He's broken a lot of tackles, shown some shiftiness, little spin move. He's a hard guy to bring down.
Another quick one. Trayvon Gray. Trayvon Brown.
Pass to number 88, Trayvon Brown.
Coming up to the end of the quarter. And that's the end of the third quarter. Mountaineers in total control. 56-13. Flag here, very end of this play.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Number three, the defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
That's Quandarius Qualls.
Well, once again, I've been in those scrums before, and it's hard sometimes to hear the whistle. Forward progress is stopped. Whistle's being blown. You know, he's just kind of finishing the play there.
First down, they're now Mountaineer territory. 37. Todd caught, hit. Now Rashid Benton.
They've been taking advantage of that this whole half. West Virginia's defense has been sitting pretty soft in their zones, allowing a lot of the checkdowns. They're getting some vertical routes on the outside, which is really stretching the corners and the safety back, and then they just throw that little checkdown in there. But once again, Benton and a bunch of their linebackers kind of making the plays and making the sure tackle. As we see Odari Christian, the second, come in from that Sam backer position as he read the play perfectly, ran the lane, and goes up and makes the play. A lot of these guys, first line of linebackers, awfully good, but the second tier linebackers are good as well.
Third and five. Gardner Minshew. It's Carolina Pirates. Goes up top. Net is knocked away. Toyus Avery.
Talked a lot about Kaiser White today, but Torres has had a nice game. He's been lined up all over the place, a little bit of corner. He's their boundary safety, but you'll see him sometimes lined up as a corner. That particular time, lined up in the slot, makes a nice break on the ball with his upfield arm to knock the ball away.
Verity, this is from 49 yards out. Jake Verity misses the field goal. 56-13 to score here in the fourth. A little over 13 minutes left in this football game. West Virginia dominating. Let's take a look at the Lieber Heisman watch.
Yeah, man. You know what? I think it's so bizarre that Lamar Jackson is not getting more love this year. Everybody's so infatuated with Rosen, which he's awfully good, with Darnold. They think this year the quarterback, but he just continues to just show that he is one of the best athletes on the field, game in and game out. I have him on top of my list. Quality opponent last week with Purdue. Another quality opponent this week. He has got a big test next week against Clemson, but Josh Rosen comes up to number two for my list just because I think that there has to be the intangibles that are factored in.
And he was getting beat up in that game against A&M in that first half.
He was getting beat up. He had the four touchdowns there in the fourth quarter, but I think when you look at just leadership, the toughness, you know, some of the intangibles that you can't measure, I think that has to be taken into consideration. That's why I think he should be up there as number two. Baker Mayfield just was nearly perfect last week, and he just continues to be a great passer and a great manager of the game. And then also Saquon Barkley. You know, there's not a better runner as far as running back in the league, and I think he's on a team that really could shine. They have a great potential to win the Big Ten again this year, and I really like him as well.
How about Sam Darnold, Jake Browning, those guys?
I mean, right now they haven't shown to me that they're better than these four guys. I think Darnold has all the attributes that you're looking for, but he hasn't really shown it. So maybe, you know, as the year goes on, he'll have more opportunity. But right now, no. I think he's going to be a great pro, but right now he's not shown to be, to me, the top caliber Heisman guy.
That pass was intended for Drew Bowen. He's the Mountaineer down.
Looks like he got tripped up just a little bit.
Yeah, that right leg. Like I said, gets caught in that carpet, man.
Right leg goes straight. A little bit of a hyperextension immediately grabs his right knee. Those are never good situations when you see the non-contact injuries of that sort.
He's up. He's good. He's the freshman out of Charleston, West Virginia. Second and 10 now for the Mountaineers. Hand off to Devin Bush. That thing was just blown up. Tyree Owens.
Tyree Owens. He got his first start in Division I level last week. First action, does a good job just splitting the offensive linemen as they were what we call elephants on parade, just kind of all moving to one side, and he split those guys, got up the field and made the play. Fourth quarter, game's out of hand, and he's still playing awfully hard.
Montel Pettaway checks into the backfield. The draw, Pettaway spins back close to the original line of scrimmage.
The ball carrier.
It's the classic third long play as a defender. As you see Bivens taking a seat. Classic third and long play. We always said as a defense, screens and draws. Screens and draws, always be ready for that. It's hard for an offensive coordinator to dial up a third and 14, third and 15 play, so you just get something. You need a cheap first down out of it, but just give your offense just a little bit more room for your punt team to go out there and play the field position game.
Bruce Bivens, a freshman out of Houston, getting helped up. Jogs off the field under his own power, which is always good to see.
Bruce Bivens, shaking out our ECU.
Talk to me about the future here at ECU. You know, talking with Coach Montgomery, who said the first year was hard. It was a year of transition for him. Mm-hmm. He's coming in. This is his second year now. He felt like they had a good camp, starting to recruit some of his guys to bring in here.
You know, I think it's going to be still another sort of transition year. You know, they bring in Kenwick Thompson as defensive coordinator, and he switched everything up. They were a 3-4 defense last year. Yeah, they weren't very good. They only had 8 sacks total on the whole year. I had to read that stat twice because I just couldn't believe it. 8 sacks throughout the whole course of the season. So they decided to go with Kenwick. He comes in, puts in a 4-2-5 defense, which is more like what TCU runs. And we'll get more to that here in a bit. We'll check what the flags are on the punt. But it's going to take a while for a lot of these new players on defense to get rolling on what Kenwick wants.
And, of course, what Coach Montgomery wants as well.
Personal foul. Legal block below the waist. Number 28 of the kicking team. 15-yard penalty. First down. Timeout.
Well, we are in Morgantown, the home opener for the Mountaineers. They're up 56-13. Thank you. One out.
Good job,
Tyshawn Dye, straight ahead.
What do you think here, a 93-yard drive?
Yeah. 97-yard drive.
I'm sorry.
See if they can put something together. You know, I like this West Virginia squad. You look at the Big 12 and obviously Oklahoma and Eddie State. This is a squad that can do some things. Goes up top. Wait a minute. And he's got a man. Trayvon Brown. Trayvon Brown is going all the way. How about it, Ben Lieber? You ask for it, you get it. 95 yards.
For the East Carolina touchdown.
And here's the guy that they're excited about. They want to get him involved in the game because he missed last week, just got medically cleared from a neck injury. And they said that this guy is the best guy that we have running after the catch. He's big and strong, showing the speed. He is a hard man to bring down. We have flags on the play. We'll get a check out that. But what an answer.
Unsportsmanlike conduct on assistant coach on ECU's sideline. That penalty will be enforced on the kickoff.
I'll let him celebrate. That is the new rule this year.
That is the unsportsmanlike foul of the game.
The coaches cannot be on the field at all. And my guess is he was celebrating Trayvon Brown's 95-yard touchdown reception.
Big Verity puts the extra point on the board. First TD catch, Trayvon Brown since 2015, and this one goes 95 yards. ECU 20, Mountaineers 56. Opener.
Let's go, Mountaineers, baby! Here we go!
That man right there is burnt out. He's done how many push-ups today? I'm not going to add it all up, but I know it's a lot.
Caleb Pratt will kick things off. Of course, the personal foul. He's got to kick it off from his own 20. This is Devin Bush. This is his own 7. Bush. Knocked out of bounds at 33.
And Bush was one of those guys that we highlighted before the game that the coaches said, man, when he's on the field, we have to get the ball in his hands. You'll see a lot of sort of gimmicky plays with him. I brought up the idea that he's your guys' version of Percy Harvin, who's at Florida, and he said that's absolutely correct. He can line up on the outside. We can throw a lot of stuff to him. We can put him in the backfield, reverses, things of that nature, but we really have not seen what they talked about in this game with their ability to use him.
The give is to Martell Petaway.
Martell Petaway got the carry.
Stop for East Carolina.
You see, finally, West Virginia's offense is going to let this clock sort of run. They run primarily at a clip about three plays every minute when their first offense is out there. And you can see the dramatic change as the course of the game, the score being what it is, and how much they want to slow this thing down. Brian, you brought up earlier in that last series just about the state of the Big 12 and where West Virginia sort of sits. You know, they were number 2 last year in the Big 12.
strong showing. I think people sort of forget. Maybe it's geographic. I'm not sure, but Oklahoma gets talked about a lot.
Yep.
Rightfully so. Oklahoma State obviously gets talked about because they're big offense. They just need to improve their defense a little bit. You know, Kansas State's been the conversation because they're returning a lot of guys offensively. They're scoring a lot of points these first two games as they score, I think, over 50 points again today, albeit it's against Charlotte. But West Virginia continues every year to surprise people, play a physical brand of football that I think Oklahoma State doesn't play. So these guys, you know, they keep playing like this. Both sides of the ball, kicking games got to get better, but they could be right there in contention as well. They can score a lot of points. Their defense can confuse a lot of people. They have a lot of playmakers on defense, and when it gets down to it, defense is going to win championships, even in an offensive-heavy Big 12.
Tim Urban back deep for the Pirates. Bill Kenny punt this one away. Rolls out of bounds. Pirates would take over. Down 36.
Yards.
47-35. Thanks,
Sam. See why I put him number one
you
on did. My list?
Hey, you called it. You said that. Not getting a lot of love.
It's a Heisman-type day.
Yeah, it's fascinating to me that before the season why he wasn't higher. You know, I know that there's a lot of good pure passers, especially in the Pac-12, but yeah, you have the reigning Heisman champ comes back. He's still the same player. You know, he's still dynamic. He's still one of the best athletes on the field.
Yeah.
And I think he's starting to show it too.
Minshew drops it off to Howell. Cuts back. Across the 30. Brandon Ferns makes the stop.
Well, not to just keep talking about it, but one more point about Jackson is next week, Clemson. If he goes out and has another great game against that defense, then everybody should start changing their lists for Heisman to put him right on top, because that would be impressive to play Purdue, North Carolina, and Clemson and play well in all three of those games.
Minshew stumbles, falls, but there's a flag on the play, and it's holding on the Pirates.
Holding, number 62, the offense. Penalties decline, was up to the play, is fourth down.
It was on Brandon Smith.
Another one of their graduate transfers. There's a whole lot of graduate transfers. Young players, redshirt freshmen, playing on offense and defense. For this Pirate team, it's going to take a while for these guys to sort of gel together.
Tevin Bush back deep. Austin Barnes punting it away. Bush, fair catch at the 31. What a day David Seals has had. 7 catches, 153 yards, 3 touchdowns, Ben Lieber.
Yeah, he's been awfully impressive. Last week it was Gary Jennings that kind of stole the show. And Seals today just had himself a game. And to me, Jake Spavital, the offensive coordinator, has called a great game, allowing these guys to get as wide open as we saw on that long touchdown pass. And they call him the technician. He really works at his craft, really wants to be a good receiver, not just catching the ball, but also just precise route running. As you see the jitterbug, Tevin Bush, get the handoff. And yes, that perspective is correct. He is 5'6". He is every bit as small as he looks. Doing a good job of just finding that lane and getting up the field. But when you have a guy that's only 5'6", he can do a good job of just naturally hanging back behind the offensive line, sort of hiding behind those guys. You see one of the best players defensively for ECU and Tim Urban coming off the field. Very gingerly.
I don't know if that's one of your best defensive players. I don't know if I have him in this game with 6 minutes left and down 36.
That's a good point. You know, West Virginia, both offense and defense, has taken a lot of their first team guys off the field. But, you know, Irvin is another one of these guys I talk about transfers. He originally was at Auburn, has come here. This is only his second game with the Pirates in this new defense. So maybe that's the idea, the mentality is, hey, we need to get our guys some reps. You know, they need to work on run fits. They need to work on those things. They need to, you know, get in some game action with his teammates out there on the first team defense. But that is the risk you take, him limping off the field like that.
Chugging off. Drew Bowen, who hyper-extended that knee at one point. Well, let's take a look here. You mentioned the transfers. They've added 5 graduate transfers, 6 JUCO players. Scotty Montgomery looks to rebuild this program in his direction.
And they've got a number of young players as well, just guys that have been recruited, redshirt freshmen, true freshmen. It's a lot of new faces for East Carolina. They got to figure out their quarterback situation first before they do anything else.
Here's Bush. He lost a yard.
The give is to Kevin Bush.
You know, at 5'6", 176 pounds, not exactly the guy that's going to plow things in there on short yard situations.
As we come under 5 minutes, Mountaineers will be looking at a third and a long one.
You know, I say you give it to Bush and on a perimeter play and see him in space.
Went off tackle there.
The give it to Tevin.
Bruce Bivens was not having it.
Bruce Bivens.
Yeah, given the situation, I think Bush, if you had that whole thing all over again, you just stick your foot in the ground, get north and south. You might only get a yard, but that's all you need.
Fourth and one. Bush again. First down.
And that's exactly what Spavital does, is, hey, line up and run the same exact play. See it again. Again, Bivens, exactly where he needs to be. You know, if that's a first down play, that's, you know, a successful play for the defense, but you just need a long 1 yard, and Bush is quick enough to stick that foot in the ground and get upfield, fall ahead for 2 yards.
Well, West Virginia has not lost a home opener since 2003. In fact, they have not dropped a home game to any unranked foe since November of 2013. Iowa State beat them here. In fact, at one point, West Virginia was up 31-7 in that game. Iowa State came back to win in triple overtime, 52-44.
You know, Iowa State's always good for one of those games. Every year, you talk about predictions in the Big 12, like, well, everybody says, oh, look out for Iowa State. They could be good, and they could. They're always in there, always competitive. Right now, I think they're up 7 points on their in-state rival, Iowa. We had that big game against Josh Allen in Wyoming last week. Allen did not look very good. Iowa's defense really stepped up, and right now it seems like Iowa State is going to win that in-state battle. Just a few minutes left in the fourth quarter.
Hey, make a call.
Well, when you look at what the Mountaineers have ahead here, they've got Delaware State coming up, and then that's when you start conference play, and Jayhawks, TCU, Texas Tech, all on the horizon. Here's third and one. Tevin Bush plows his way for another first down. And we got flags again come raining in.
Hey,
West Virginia has now run for over 200 yards on the ground.
Personal foul, continuing to participate without a helmet on, number 10 of the offense. It's a 15-yard penalty, third down.
Well, take a look at that schedule you were talking about, Brian. Really, to me, pretty favorable. Kansas, you know, still rebuilding. TCU playing better, but maybe not exactly where TCU's been the last couple of years. Texas Tech gets, they come here. Baylor, I think we all understand what's going on there. Matt Rhule's doing the best that he can to sort of bring that program back up.
How about that gig on October 28th?
Well, at least you get him at home with Oklahoma State, and then Kansas State's going to be a tough one. That'll be a tough one at home as well, but Oklahoma, they are at Oklahoma. Yeah, that's going to be a tough one. That'll end out and round out the season, but they've got some tough games in there. But like I said, with this balance of offense, the way this defense plays, I think they can play with anybody in this conference. And you got to watch out for West Virginia.
Petaway gets the carry. We are winding things down here. Looks like the Mountaineers about to pick up their first victory of the season.
Some of these passes, does a really good job of just putting loft on the football and having his receivers go out and make some plays. A lot of the things that the coaches wanted to see out of him in this game, as far as the natural progression in this offense, is just throwing the ball with better accuracy and timing down the field. And I tell you what, I think, you know, in the short week that he had this week, he really improved on that. Jake Spavital, the offensive coordinator, called a great game. A lot of plays were wide open for him to throw the ball to, but he's always looked in command. He's got a great competitive spirit. He's had a heck of a game. I expect a heck of a season from Will Grier this year.
See Jake Spavital give a nice pat on the back there to Dana Overs. Dana's never lost a home opener since he's been here in West Virginia. That streak continues.
Well, big play on that last series for East Carolina. See if they air it out again. Maybe they get another big score.
You never know. That one in and out of the hands. So now you had Thomas Cirque took over for Gardner Minshew. What do you do now?
Look at the next game, East Carolina.
You know what? I like the way Gardner's come in. Cirque apparently has left the game because of injury. Gardner comes in, and I thought he's delivered the ball nicely. He's shown a lot of velocity. He's thrown in tight windows. I don't know. I mean, I guess it's going to be an internal thing. How they feel the team responds best to which personality, which guy has the best leadership qualities, because when you look at physically what they can do on the field, I think Gardner's been throwing the ball a little bit better than Cirque did today.
Well, today's game was produced by the pride of East Carolina University, Kevin Patterson. You want to talk about a game day player.
He's hurting a little bit right now.
Yeah, KP is that guy. Directed by Dustin Dente, the associate director, Tyler Dare. Broadcast associate Trevor Hayes, Bo Chapman on those stats, Darren Bridges, Spotter, Josh Franz, we call him Flannel, he's crunching the numbers, our technical producer is Hill Thornell, and technical director Ernest Bauer.
You call him Flannel?
I don't think I even knew that. You're making up nicknames.
West Virginia gets their first victory of the season. They're 1-1. Pirates, East Carolina, they're 0-2. Dana Holgorsen, the
is perfect when it comes to home openers. That's all here from Morgantown, West Virginia. Tune in to a doubleheader college football action on Fox. First, Nebraska taking on Oregon at 4 Eastern, followed by the Heisman hopeful Sam Darnold. Number 6, USC, taking on number 14, Stanford. It was the Gold Rush, the annual Gold Rush game. Mountaineers now 9-2 in those games. Our final score here from Morgantown, West Virginia 56, East Carolina 20. For Ben Lieber, I'm Brian Custer. Goodbye from Morgantown.